Hey everyone, thanks for tuning in. Dr. Steve Arndt with Southeast Orthopedic Specialists, and we are going to today talk about bunions and everything you wanted to know about bunions. I've got a lot of slides, but I will sort of point out what I think are the most important ones, and at least the ones I get asked about the most. And I think that's going to kind of give a good overview. The focus is going to be a little bit about some of the surgical procedures to correct them, when to do them, why to do them, some of the pros and cons, and then, you know, seeing if that's something that makes sense, why we would do it one way versus another way, and kind of help to sort of parse through what the best way to approach a bunion really is. You can submit your questions, and I'll kind of take a look, and we'll answer as many as possible at the end and go from there. So, you know, like I said, there's a lot of content. I'll kind of highlight what I think is the most important stuff so that we have that going forward. Okay. So bunion means turnip in Latin, kind of a bump. This is kind of a visual picture of it. How do you know if you got one? Well, you can kind of look at your foot and see a protruding bump, and that's a good chance that you have a bunion. So it's used really to denote any enlargement over the big toe joint, the first MTP joint. And the term hallux valgus, which we have to some extent used synonymously with bunion, but that really refers more to the lateral position of the toe kind of relative to the metatarsal. So that's the metatarsal bone angling one way and the toe angling another. That's really hallux valgus. A bunion itself could be a straight toe with a bone spur, a ganglion cyst, any kind of growth off of it. But really what we're talking about here is hallux valgus, that kind of lateral position of the toe relative to the metatarsal. And so it's really an exposed portion of the metatarsal head that you're seeing. It's not a true growth or spur or something we can just kind of pluck out or cut out a lot of times. So people ask what causes it or why do they get it? We do know shoes play a big role. The more narrow shoes that there are, especially at the toe box, the more they'll increase that toe to go lateral. And so footwear like this commonly can be a cause of it. But that doesn't really tell the whole picture. There's a pretty high incidence of bunions in people who never wore those types of shoes, or in societies that haven't even worn shoes at all, people can still get bunions. So while shoe wear plays a role, it doesn't tell the whole story. We think obviously there's a family history, genetics. A lot of people come in and say, I've got my mom or dad's feet, or my mom's feet did this. How do I stop that from happening? Obviously, there's a lot of anatomical components to a bunion where we get, you know, hypermobility of joints, the shape of the metatarsal heads. Flat feet commonly can sort of create bunions just by the way the foot hits the ground. And so all that kind of plays into how we get a bunion. So it really is a complex deformity, and since we don't have one great cause, it's pretty challenging to prevent. We know that joint instability plays a big role, and we know that all these other potentially genetic and extrinsic factors like shoe wear also can play a role. So when I have someone come in and they're looking at their bunion and that's what they want to be seen for, X-rays are always necessary. That's probably one of the first things that we like to do, and typically weight-bearing X-rays. We want to see what the angles are, and we'll look at some of the angles later. And then I want to get an assessment of kind of what sort of shoes do you wear? What shoes are you hoping to wear? What activities can you do? What activities do you want to do? How often does it hurt? What kind of work do you do? Because all these kind of play into our decision-making and how we approach it. And so this just highlights that, you know, no matter what you know, everyone gets bunions is the bottom line. And no one really is immune to them, regardless of kind of station in life. So when I'm looking at the foot, we always want to look at kind of corns and calluses. That indicates that there's been a shift of weight bearing or load in a certain area. We want to see about range of motion of the toe. Is it stiff? Is it flexible? Is it fixed? Is there a flat foot? Is it very stiff? Is the Achilles tendon tight? Look at kind of how, and the biggest thing is, not only how they walk, but really just standing, because the appearance of the foot when not standing is quite different than when someone is standing. And that often, has a big role in exacerbating or making the bunion look quite a bit worse. So sometimes someone will come in and say, hey, I've got a bad bunion, and I'm looking at the foot while they're sitting down and I'm thinking that doesn't look all that bad. And then they stand up and all of a sudden the big toe goes over the second toe or underneath it and crosses over, and you're like, wow, okay, you were not lying. That's real. And that's something that's worth looking at. So pain typically is kind of over the prominence of the medial eminence, over the prominence of the first metatarsal head. Sometimes it can be underneath. A lot of times it's underneath the second metatarsal head. And a lot of times people can have pain that is even on the outside part of their foot. So someone will come in with a large bunion and say it's hurting on the by the little toe, or it's hurting on the outside part of the foot. In a lot of times that's because, well, hey, it hurts in the big toe and they're kind of avoiding it. They're transferring their weight to the little toe and the fifth metatarsal areas with smaller bones, and it's creating pain. And even though it doesn't necessarily hurt right over the bunion, that bunion itself can be causing walking differently, which will increase pain on the outside part of the foot. So it's not just pain in the bunion that necessarily hurts. It can be on the outside part of the foot too. So again, inspect while standing. And this is an example, someone standing, the toe crosses over the second toe. We'll see some calluses. We look at any kind of hypermobility in the foot itself. This is one where the big toe goes over the second toe. And these are classic pictures of pretty severe or significant bunions. It doesn't always have to be this bad, but these are, when it crosses over the second toe, you have a significant issue. So I always take weight-bearing x-rays. Like we said before, weight-bearing is one of the areas where, the bunion can change to some extent, and certainly look worse typically when standing. And this is kind of the x-ray look. So the picture on the left, relatively straight. What you kind of look at there is the big toe and the second toe. Not only are the toes, but the metatarsals themselves are sort of lined up straight. And on the right side, you can see that metatarsal bone, there's a space. It makes a V. The first and second sort of metatarsal bones make a V. And that's kind of what the appearance of the bunion is on x-ray. And that's one of the areas we know that we have to kind of look at and consider. We take a look at the joints themselves. Is the joint subluxated, dislocated, or is it still well aligned? While we may have a bunion, is the joint still well aligned? And then there's several other angles we're going to look at on x-ray. How big is the bunion itself, the actual angle of the toe to the metatarsal? How big is that angle between the first and second? That angle seems to indicate, a lot of the ways that we want to treat the bunions. So normal in that is less than 9 degrees, mild up to 12, moderate 12 to 16, severe bigger than 16. And that angle really helps to determine what the best procedure is as well. So that's one of the things we use to kind of help determine where should we do a surgery, what type of surgery should be done for it. This is the angle. Sometimes we have an angle at the actual end of the toe, and occasionally that has to be addressed as well. You can have a very straight looking metatarsal, but still have what looks like a bunion, and the angle may be coming from there. And then this is one that we want to address or at least think about quite a bit. And this is sort of the takeoff of the first metatarsal from kind of what we call the medial cuneiform, or an area in the foot. And so this is what increases that intermetatarsal angle. And if this is a large angle, a lot of times we have to do work to correct that angle. So we know bunions are to some extent a 3D problem. We know that it's an angulation with the metatarsal sticking out. We know that there can be some elevation or flexion of it. We also know that it can rotate, okay? And so we think of it as sort of an unstable foundation, all right? What we also know about bunions, and this is important, this is a slide that I get asked quite a bit. Bunions don't go away on their own, and they're progressive. And what that means is bunions always get worse. The bunion will always get larger, always. Now, it doesn't mean that tomorrow it's going to get larger or in a week, but if I see you one day and then I see you in 10 years, your bunion will be larger, okay? And that may have some treatment implications. It's not to say that there's any value in doing a preventative surgery or that we should intervene early, but it is helpful to know that if you have a bunion, it's going to get larger. Could take 40 years, but it's going to get larger, okay? And then to lead on that, well, what happens if it does get larger? What does that mean? Well, as it gets worse, arthritis can develop in that joint. There was a slide I probably breezed over that talked about congruent or incongruent joints, but as the bunion gets worse, the joint of the first metatarsal often gets more incongruent or irregular, and that can lead to some of the cartilage loss, and that can lead to arthritis. Toes can start to cross over, which can lead to hammer toes. Spurring can develop at the big toe, and you can start having some pain in some of these second, third, fourth balls of the foot. So if we start with a simple bunion and every other toe is normal, sometimes you just have to treat that simple bunion. However, as the bunion gets worse, it can affect other areas of the foot. It can become arthritic. And so what I try to tell people is if we don't intervene now, it's not a big deal. Understand we can almost always have a treatment that will fix the bunion. However, if it gets worse, it may involve other things. It could lead to a hammer toe that you might want fixed. It could lead to arthritis that we might have to address. I say that at the same point in time, it doesn't always do that. And it's very difficult to predict which ones will. And so if you have a bunion that you're worried about, but it's not yet necessarily really painful or you're not ready for a surgical intervention, it's probably something that close follow-up, and close follow-up doesn't mean weekly x-rays, but you know, 6 months to a year of kind of evaluation to see where we're at is probably worthwhile to look at it if you want to get to a point where we don't get to a hammer toe, or we don't get to arthritis, or we don't get to a crossover toe, since we do know the natural history is those things can happen. So one of the misconceptions, and we touched on it before, we can't just shave it off or cut it off. It's unfortunately a little more complicated than that because it involves so much of the metatarsal and the phalanx. And so I always sort of start with conservative management, okay? And I'll touch on surgical management quite a bit, but conservative management. And so the mainstay really, in my opinion, is shoe wear. In kind of wide, soft leather shoes, wide toe box, good stiff sole, right? Just shoes that you feel comfortable in. Now, most people, by the time they come in, have already tried several different shoes, types of shoes. So me saying that isn't necessarily reinventing the wheel there. People kind of already know that aspect of it. Activity modification, you know, people don't typically, if they say, hey, it hurts really bad if I have to wear my tennis shoes or if I go for long walks, but I like long walks. If I say, well, if it only hurts when you do long walks, you know, stop doing long walks, not a great solution. You know, most of the time, like not doing the inciting event isn't going to be super satisfactory as a treatment option. Unless it's truly something you can give up. But in general, wide, comfortable shoes. If you can find a pair of shoes that you're comfortable in, 9 times out of 10, that's going to be the route we go in, okay? Ice, anti-inflammatories when it's sore. Cortisone, not used a ton in bunions because a lot of times the pain is over the medial eminence, and you know, injecting that area. There's not a true capsule, but sometimes you can do a cortisone shot into the joint if you think there's some maybe early arthritis or incongruency. So that can be an option. There's a number of devices, and I give a lot of these out. The important thing to note with these devices is, well, toe spacers and inserts and splints and pads, they can help relieve some discomfort. They can absolutely help to sort of put the toe in a better position. They can help make it feel more comfortable in shoes, but they really don't correct anything. They're not going to correct or reduce any bunion deformity. There's a little bit of debate in kids if they can. Kids still have open growth plates, so can you to some extent guide their growth with one of these? But even then, it doesn't seem to be of much benefit. And it's even questionable if it will slow down any deformity progression. The thought is that in order to slow down deformity progression, you would virtually have to wear a pad or toe spacer or splint nonstop, not even take it off at all. And that's pretty challenging from a compliance standpoint. So, you know, to sort of say, hey, this could slow it down, it's very debatable. So when I give these out, it's often to, you know, help with pain, help reduce pressure areas, take the first toe off the second toe. And I will say this may help slow down some deformity progression, but there's no guarantee. I certainly don't give it out and say, hey, this is going to make your bunion, you know, get worse, slower. We don't know that. And then these are just some examples kind of that, spacers and splints and pads and things that have been tried. And again, good for comfort, not necessarily fixing, correcting, or solving any problems. Not bad to try, certainly not harmful. And if it works or does seem to slow down progression, I think it's very reasonable to try. Okay. So surgical indications are kind of when the pain and the deformity really interfere with your desired activities, non-operative management, shoe wear modifications, inserts, ice, anti-inflammatories are not working. The pain is kind of beyond what you want to do. And I usually use it as a guide of like, hey, I can't get into X shoe and X shoe allows me to do this, or I can't do this activity because my bunion's bothering me too much. Yeah, that's when we talk about sort of treatment options. Cosmetic reasons, really, in my opinion, not a big indication, right? So if you have a bunion that causes no pain, no activity interference, no issues, no problems, I usually am not a big proponent of doing it, mostly because I know post-surgically you're going to have pain and there's going to be a scar, and it's hard to improve upon no pain from my standpoint. And so it doesn't typically yield, one, a great surgical outcome, but two, you know, satisfaction, not great with that. And I kind of think about it, and this is sort of some of the decision tree we go through. Is there arthritis? What does the joint look like? What doesn't it look like? But as I get through some of the specific surgical procedures, the kind of one thing I want people to really think about is sort of any foot surgery, not really just bunions, but foot surgery in general. And I think it's important in bunions is a balance between doing the best job skeletally or bony, right? Making the bones look perfect, because there's a lot of value in that, versus managing any soft tissue or wound issues. The foot doesn't get great blood supply. It's dependent. It swells. The nerves and blood flow are very erratic, hypersensitive. And so it's prone to delayed wound healing and delayed wound complications. So at the same time, we want to do, if the foot was just a skeleton, there's certain procedures we would do every time. Okay. And if the foot wasn't and was always, you know, was never going to have a wound complication, there's things we could always do. But we have to balance to some extent mild versus moderate versus severe, and knowing, you know, a little bit about the patient's history and how much of a wound can we make, how big of a incision can they tolerate? And I think when we balance a lot of these procedures, that's some of the things we really think about is kind of, okay, I think this needs this correction. Can the skin tolerate it? Or you know what? I think this can get away with something maybe more minimally invasive. It may not skeletally be perfect, but I think it's going to be really good and we're not going to run into any wound issues. And those are kind of the big decisions in the back of my mind. So, you know, one of the common ones, and we're going to kind of talk about mild deformity and more severe, because by and large, that's where people kind of live in. And so in mild deformities, we always think about like these distal osteotomies, making our cut very close to the joint, not having to come into the foot or anywhere like that. And we can do this cut minimally invasive. Now, full disclosure, we are pushing the envelope on this procedure to do it for severe bunions and bigger bunions all the time. And a lot of the things we think about with that are really, can I get a good correction? Can I do a small incision? And does it matter if the bone is perfect or well aligned or corrected? And the answer is sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. So with minimally invasive surgery, we want to minimize any wound issues. So traditionally, bunion surgery would have a large incision, and several surgeries still do. Minimally invasive, there's special tools where we can use to make just poke holes. So the one on the left would be a traditional sort of distal osteotomy incision, and you can do it on the top or on the side. Whereas the one on the right, we're doing it through two or sometimes three pokes to achieve the same correction. And what you find is that you can percutaneously put in screws. You can line up the bones. These are some examples of what it looks like afterwards on the left, the x-rays, two screws kind of threaded into the metatarsal head to hold it in place. And really you get good correction. You still can see on the bottom, on the right picture, you still see a little bump. You'll notice that it's not necessarily perfect or bony perfect, okay? And the question is, does it matter? And I think a lot of the times the answer is no, that's a really good correction. Some of the issues with this would be, when do you need a great correction versus when can you get away with it? And that's really a case-by-case basis. I'll give some sort of pros and cons to each one. But minimally invasive surgery and even pushing the envelope. So if I had someone with a severe bunion who had potentially diabetes, even with a severe bunion, I would be much more likely to do a minimally invasive technique, knowing that there's really not going to be many wound healing complications. And while the bony correction may not be as perfect as if I were able to, open up the entire foot, it's going to be much better than it is. And we're not going to run into some of those delayed wound healing issues. So some of those are much quicker. It's also a relatively faster recovery in the sense that the wounds themselves heal quicker. So the advantages, like we talked about, decreased wound complications, increased return to activity, shorter recovery time, earlier range of motion, less immobilization, typically less post-op pain, all good. Complications. It is technically demanding. It's very challenging to do. The angles that you have to make for your screws can be difficult. The less precise correction, right? It's less likely to make the bone perfect, difficult to control for rotation. It is difficult, as we saw in that one picture, to kind of adequately shave the side of the metatarsal. So you still may see what looks like a little bump. And there may be a higher incidence of recurrence since you didn't get it at the right, the root cause or at the takeoff of the sort of metatarsal where it takes off from the midfoot or the cuneiform, you do have a higher incidence of recurrence. So these are some things to think about. And these are, options that we'll discuss in clinic about why I think one may be better than another. The next procedure that I do, and I'm going to talk about really two main ones, right? There's a distal osteotomy, which we can do minimally invasive. And then there's a proximal osteotomy. So the Lapidus procedure, and I'm going to talk about a specific way to do it. There's a number of kind of techniques, but we'll highlight one. This is the correction at the first tarsometatarsal joint, or the first metatarsal cuneiform joint, the Lapidus procedure. And this kind of goes at what we call the root cause. So you'll see this Leaning Tower of Pisa picture again, I think. And that's sort of where this goes. So this procedure, the Lapidus, gets at correcting the bunion in all three planes, as well as fixing rotation, since we know that bunions are malaligned in multiple dimensions. We know that bunions that are not fixed this way do have a higher rate of recurrence. They have a higher rate of dissatisfaction, and over time can recur. And so one of the companies that I've worked with, and this is, there's a couple that do similar to this, but it's called Lapiplasty, sort of gets at the root of the problem, the takeoff of that sort of first metatarsal cuneiform joint, to sort of help stabilize that, in essentially restoring the natural anatomy and restoring the intermetatarsal angle. The thought here is you're essentially getting it back to the right appropriate structure that it's supposed to be. And so your risk of recurrence goes lower. And this is where, you know, you're really skeletally aligning the joint in the best position. So certainly for more severe bunions, I think this is a better option. It's going to line up the toe nicely. It's going to take it at the root problems. I don't think for necessarily mild bunions, this is always indicated. It's probably, quite honestly, overkill for mild bunions. I don't think you need to do this for those. But if you are getting in the sort of moderate to severe range, that IM angle is 13, 14 degrees and higher, we're seeing a big bump, any kind of rotation of the toe. If you look at your toenail and you see that it looks kind of rotated one way or another, this is probably going to be a good long-standing procedure. And you can look at kind of the picture on the left where it does that sort of distal osteotomy, but you can still see how the toe is to some extent taken off crooked or bent, that angle isn't resolved. And that can lead to an increased incidence of recurrence or still a more pronounced bump. Whereas on the right, you can see that you have good correction of, you know, the first and second toes, and the metatarsals really line up pretty straight, which does seem to provide good stable release. So this is kind of an example of what we would do in a minimally invasive surgery on the left. We're shifting that head a lot. We still have, to some extent, the curved metatarsal. You're still gonna probably have a little bump present. It is probably going to be a much better situation than it was. It's going to look pretty straight. The question is, will it have a higher rate of recurrence? Is this bunion too large to do that with versus the procedure on the right where we're kind of fixing it or straightening it out and really getting it at the root? If you get it at that takeoff, you know the incidence of recurrence is going to be quite a bit lower. The reason I like the what I call Lapiplasty, this procedure, is on the left, doing a bunion surgery at the first tarsal metatarsal joint or doing a traditional Lapidus is, and I see this in my clinic every day, it's really, really hard to get the joint, the first tarsal metatarsal joint, to both fuse and get the angular correction at the same time. Really hard. So we either see one of two things a lot of times. We see, because the Lapidus itself is a very technically demanding procedure. So we see either a well-angled first metatarsal cuneiform joint that isn't healed, or we see a fused first metatarsal cuneiform joint that's basically fused in the position it was, and we don't get great bunion correction. And what I think the Lapiplasty technique has really done is it has kind of accounted for both of those problems. And there are a number of companies who do similar things. I just happen to think this is the most efficient. And it's the best way, in my opinion, to both line up the first metatarsal and get it to heal in the appropriate position versus a more traditional, which can be much more technically demanding. And not to say it can't be done without this, because it most certainly can, and many people do. it's just a little trickier. There's a couple tools they have. And so these are just some examples of pre and post-op corrections. And I think that, you know, the results are pretty significant. The biggest, issue, and we'll talk a little bit about recovery for bunions in general, I usually let you put some pressure down on your foot in the first couple of weeks. That being said, it's really dependent on the wound. And so for me, my wound healing will to some extent dictate my weight bearing. So structurally, it's absolutely fine to put weight on it within the first few days. However, the more you keep it up, iced, elevated, absolutely the faster the skin heals, the easier it is to put pressure on it. Okay. Walking boot for probably around 6 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks, depending on swelling, is going to be transitioning into comfortable shoes. And then somewhere probably 3 months, if x-rays look good, we'll start the process of weaning you back to sort of routine activity. But in the first few weeks until the sutures come out, the more you keep the foot elevated, absolutely the better you'll feel, the quicker the wound will heal, and the faster you'll be able to progress on. So some of the advantages of the Lapidus Lapiplasty approach: good for severe bunions, a more anatomic correction, stable fixation, lower rate of recurrence, good reduction of pain long-term, and less other issues that could occur in the foot, transfer issues, other pain issues. To me, the disadvantage is really my top line: wound issues, and more wound issues. It's not minimally invasive. And even though they'll come out with some minimally invasive techniques, it still requires a handful of incisions around the foot. The foot's not extremely well suited to tolerate a number of incisions. And so that's a concern. And that probably is what really delays kind of progression and healing and really advancing to the next step. And while the construct of fixation is stable and certainly the bone can tolerate some of the early wound healing, the wounds themselves don't really allow for that early weight bearing that we want. So those are some of the complications there. So I think in this is a good kind of, you're balancing good bony fixation with potentially delayed wound healing in minimally invasive. You know you're going to get good wound healing. Are you fixing the bone as stably as you need to? Is there going to be more recurrence? I'm going to briefly touch over MTP fusion just because if the bunion gets so bad that we lead to a lot of arthritis, the most common cause, a lot of times we'll fuse the big toe because it takes care of both arthritis and the bunion at the same time, aligns it. We do that with a plate and screws. Recovery is going to be not terribly dissimilar to a bunion. The biggest failures of bunion are typically recurrence. The bunion comes back. Either the right procedure wasn't chosen, chose a procedure that didn't recognize all the angles, or chose a procedure that wasn't strong enough to do what it asked. Sometimes we overcorrect, we over-tighten, we over-resect, we over-move a bone. And then wound complications, I think, especially with the open procedures, the bigger procedures, those are going to be some of the biggest complications that we see. So for me, the surgical choice, we're going to talk about the severity of the bunion. How big is it? The more severe the bunion, the more likely we'll do a Lapidus procedure, barring any wound issues. And then we'll kind of talk about, you know, Will waiting to have surgery make a difference? Is it going to change anything? Should we just do some routine maintenance? And I always think about it's really a balance between how much soft tissue injury am I going to incur or have versus what's the most appropriate surgery and long-term stable fixation. So those are kind of some of the discussions, but I just wanted to kind of give an overview, talk about some of the procedures I do. And hopefully that was informative and not too technical. Thank you. Happy to answer any questions. So one question, a Taylor's bunion is a bunion off the fifth MTP joint. So if we think about the classic hallux valgus being off the big toe, a Taylor's bunion is essentially a bunion off the small toe and really approached in a similar fashion. It's the fifth metatarsal sort of angling out, much like the first metatarsal would. And as it angles out, it causes a small bump there. Treatment is kind of similar in conservative measures and wide shoes and things like that. And then as it gets big or beyond that, we talk about some surgical options, whether it is a spur that we can shave versus sometimes having to make a cut to shift the bone. But essentially Taylor's bunion is a fifth MTP joint or small toe area bunion. So it depends on the procedure. It depends on the article you read. In certain studies, like the one quoted earlier, 70% of bunions with rotational deformities not addressed can recur. Generally speaking, there's an 8 to 20% chance of recurrence, all comers. So, you know, 1 in 10 to 2 in 10 chance that the bunion can grow back. And that percentage is going to be highly dependent on how bad the bunion was in the first place and what procedure was chosen. And I would argue that realistically, almost all bunions will have a slight recurrence. Now, it may be non-clinically significant, right? So that 8 to 20% is kind of a clinically significant recurrence. But if you look at what toe might angle back a little, where you say, hey, it angled back a little bit, it doesn't bother me, I don't see a bump, but it looked like it angled back, that's over 50%. Bunions can't really occur on your middle toes. You can get arthritis of your middle toes. You can get bone spurs of your middle toes. You can get bumps and growths on them. I shouldn't say a bunion can't necessarily occur, because you absolutely can have an angulation. We just would more classically call that like a hammer toe or a medially or laterally deviated toe. We wouldn't really refer to it as a bunion, but you can absolutely get angular deformities at the second, third, and fourth toes. We kind of approach those more in line with like how we would approach hammer toe surgery. So good question. And numbness absolutely at the tip of your toe can be a symptom. So there's a digital nerve or a cutaneous nerve that kind of runs over that metatarsal, and it absolutely, especially with shoe wear and pressure on it, can absolutely lead to some numbness at the tip of the toe. So there's no question that there can be nerve involvement, numbness running across the big toe, numbness at the tip of the toe that can be a symptom of a bunion. The answer to both surgeries at the same time is you can. It's challenging. And the reason is, realistically, you're not going to put a lot of weight on it in the beginning. And so what I tell people who want to do both at the same time, and we do both at the same time, is you need to almost plan to have a wheelchair for the first couple of weeks, because you're not going to want to put a ton of pressure on either side, and you're going to want to keep each one elevated. So if you have the ability to, for a couple of weeks, kind of be shut down and elevating both feet and not doing much, you can do both at the same time. But if you want to be, to some extent, mobile or functional, it's very challenging. But yes, the short answer is yes, we can do both at the same time. The follow-up is, in the first few weeks, it's going to be logistically challenging on the patient. So the implants, the plates and screws, do not ever need to be replaced. They can be removed. So once the bone heals, sometimes people can have some hardware irritation. That's about 5 to 8% of people will say, hey, I can feel this screw head. I can feel this plate. And once the bone is healed, we can take it out. But for the most part, they're intended to be in there forever. And we don't really plan on removing them unless they cause some irritation or an issue. There hasn't been necessarily a study on specific sports. However, any sport with narrow shoes, so like soccer and baseball and even football, where the shoes kind of come narrow, there's been some link to soccer as maybe something that would be increased incidence of bunions just because of the shoes that they wear. Age a little bit figures into treatment options, but not necessarily. I would say with age comes a slightly higher incidence of arthritis. And so if there's arthritis at the joint, that can factor in a little bit to some of the treatment options. And that's something to bring up. But age alone, not necessarily. The only other thing with age that I would say is age can sometimes bring some issues that would cause maybe a delay in wound healing. And so maybe a wound healing issue would also be something to bring up. So maybe think about something more minimally invasive if there was a concern about wound healing. But age itself from a bone structure shouldn't really impact it. Yes, I we do that all the time. I mean, the high recurrence rate leads to a lot of revisions. Most of the revisions are on surgeries that were probably not, maybe not the right procedure was chosen and it recurred. And so now you can do a stronger procedure, but a Lapidus is often done. That first tarsometatarsal joint fusion is often done as a revision procedure. Fusing the big toe can be done as a revision procedure, or you can redo the distal osteotomy cut, but we do revision bunions all the time. That goes along to kind of what I was saying earlier about the, when you can have a bunion, and because you don't necessarily want to put all your weight on the bunion or under it, you can start to almost subconsciously put weight on other areas of the foot, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth metatarsal, and you can develop stress fractures. So it wouldn't be to necessarily say, hey, your bunion did this, but more, hey, you were walking on tile and you maybe were avoiding your bunion or putting all your pressure there. You started putting some pressure on the lesser toes, the lesser bones. And that's what caused this stress reaction, because they weren't as well suited to kind of handle that load. So while it's not the direct cause, no question a bunion can contribute to stress fractures in other areas of the foot. Good question too. There was some articles done on like whether you can kind of stretch or hold the big toe over. The answer is probably not. It slowing the progression is really challenging. The best advice I would give is do like a toe spacer and do it as much as you possibly can. But in general, even with that, the bunions still typically tend to progress, but maybe like a toe spacer or something in there that's holding the toe straight could at least slow it down a little bit. So a bunion can cause some nerve issues at the tip of the toe. It probably will not cause anything, what we'd say, proximal to it or more toward the ankle. It shouldn't cause any issue. Now, could be a nerve issue already going on that actually can contribute to a bunion by some muscle imbalance, but the bunion itself, I would not expect to be the cause of a nerve issue more toward the ankle or up the leg, no.